Hello and welcome to Soberanía, the Mexican politics podcast. I'm your co-host, José Luis Granados Ceja, a Mexican-born journalist living and working in Mexico City. I write for Venezuela Analysis, as well as serve as editor of the Mexico Solidarity Media website. And I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, Kurt Hackbarth. Welcome.
Hello, José Luis. Here we are for the next episode of Soberanía. My name is Kurt Hackbarth of Jacobin Magazine and Sentido Común.
Well, this week we have something interesting to talk about, which is López Obrador, for the first time, if I'm not mistaken, in his presidency, that's just to say since 2018, on the airwaves inside the United States. There's a lot of noise here in Mexico about López Obrador's interview with 60 Minutes, which aired last night. We're recording on Monday, on Sunday night. And, well, there was a lot of noise about it beforehand, a lot of talk about, well, what's, you know, are they going to really grill him? Are they going to hold his feet to the fire? You'll remember that there was some controversy, some made-up controversy, if we're being honest, about his interview with Ina Afino Genova from En Red Media, which is linked to Pablo Iglesias in Spain, saying, oh, he only grants interviews to people who are going to give him softball questions or freedom-friendly media outlets. Well, you have 60 Minutes, probably the most watched news magazine in the United States, doing this interview. But I will say that one thing that I found disappointing was just how short it was. I think if you have a world leader, the stature of López Obrador, and also considering that Mexico is in the midst of an election, the U.S. is also in its very long election period, which we can arguably say has already begun, bordering country, the number one trade partner of the United States, and ultimately the only thing that made it to air was about 13 minutes. Nonetheless, kind of important, I think pretty significant, the fact that this was the feature segment during 60 Minutes last night, airing on Sunday night. And one thing that I think I want to begin our conversation with is how disappointing it was to see how they pretty much stuck to very predictable topics. What is to say, the border, drugs, and crime. It seems to be that when anybody in the United States thinks of Mexico, that's what they think of. And
that's
it ends up being kind of
as far as the imagination gets, right?
Yeah. God forbid that they actually try to find something out, something new about their southern neighbor that is so important to the commercial, political, social, whatever relationship you want to say between the two countries. But one thing that, you know, like I said, I think that really kind of stood out to me is just how narrow that vision was. And a lack of curiosity, a lack of a willingness to get to know and to really kind of probe this relationship. And what does it mean? Instead, we mostly got some platitudes. We mostly had the same old kind of conversation about, the, you know, we're friends and neighbors, et cetera, et cetera. But without saying too much, I want to hand it over to you, Kurt. What were your initial impressions? What did you think about the whole thing? The fact that he was on the program, what he said, what the questions were about. And then later on, I think we should get into a bit of the reaction here and inside the United States.
Yeah, I agree with you in the sense that the interview really shows the limitations of American corporate media, both in the length, the 13 minutes. Then there was some extra. They did a four-minute extra for online consumption, which actually I think was actually more interesting than the standard 13 minutes, right?
That's exactly what I was going to say. I think I would encourage people to check it out. It's on YouTube. It's on the CBS website. There are no region restrictions, it looks like. So check out that part in particular. The bonus segment, I think, was the most interesting
AMLO really
part.
Goes into the sovereignty argument and really, you know, lays out the case that Mexico is not a colony and a protectorate and such. But, this, you know, the meat of the interview was very much, you know, they were questions by someone who didn't do much homework and didn't really care to. Right, someone who obviously doesn't know much about Mexico. 60 Minutes obviously has plenty of a budget and a team to have, you know, gone into more nuanced questions. They really didn't. It stood very much along very predictable lines. Our friend Jesus Hermosillo did an interesting breakdown on this. Follow him on Twitter if you haven't already. It's Chewy90023. And he lays out some of the problems with the interview, just lazy stuff, right? They called Claudia Sheinbaum AMLO's handpicked successor and didn't even go into the process of how Sheinbaum was selected as a candidate, right? So Chewy says, was Hillary also Obama's handpicked candidate? Was that what 60 Minutes would have contended in 2016? They went after AMLO for the New York Times for doxing Natalie Kitdrift's number at the New York Times, but didn't go after, you know, didn't go into much detail about the lack of substance of these attacks on AMLO itself, right? They focused on the doxing part, you know, kind of the more, the concern more of that media circle. Talks about, tries to back up, we'll talk about this in a moment, Mexico's supposed lack of advance in corruption and impunity by citing some very questionable NGOs. Didn't talk enough about the effects of U.S. guns flooding across the border, et cetera, right? And all that speaks to, you know, an environment where American reporters, by and large, know very little about Mexico and don't care to know more about it. That said, I also agree with you that just the fact that AMLO was on 60 Minutes, which, you know, within America's very controlled media ecosystem is one of prestige, is important. That the Mexican president got at least a little bit of time to make his case. For example, to lay out his immigration counterproposal. Right? The level of debate in the U.S. on immigration is so low. You know, it's just so bottom of the barrel. Build the wall! Kick them all out! Arrest them! Throw them out! Just all kind of, just, you know, the most base arguments from a lot of base people. No attempt on either side of the aisle really to understand the nuance of it. Or even begin to understand U.S. historical complicity, right, in this. So in that environment, you know, I was back in the U.S. in December and January, and all they were just screaming about open borders as if the borders were open. So just in that environment, which is only getting worse as you know the campaign gets underway in the United States, just the fact that AMLO had a few minutes to lay out his proposal, to give you know some nuance to this, to give the Mexican side, just that. Was important, you know, the rather mediocre quality of the interviewing itself aside. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I did a tour in the United States not too long ago, and likewise was quite surprised at how little people knew about Mexico, but, you know, at the very least, people at least know who he is, know his name. They were honest about one thing, I will say this, that they actually did talk about the fact that he believes in universal social programs, that he believes in these cash transfer programs. That was mentioned oftentimes, as we've mentioned on this program in many occasions, that they leave that out. They talk about how his Republican austerity without actually talking about the context in which that Republican austerity is taking place, and actually talks about the fact that this is a progressive leftist government. This is a government that is investing in the vast majority of the people. And so I'll give them credit in that sense. And I threw up here on the screen the Twitter account for Jesus Hermosillo. As you said, he broke it down. And I was hoping you actually could help us with this next point that he makes here in this thread, where he talks about the fact that the interviewer cites Mexico Evalúa as a credible source of information. We've talked about these U.S.-funded organizations, but I think it's worth revisiting because this is actually quite a very good example of the way the manufacturing of consent, this generating of thought is done by putting out these organizations, mentioning them in, almost in passing in an interview like this without actually saying what their deal is, who are they actually representing, who funds them, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's worth taking a few moments here to talk about who is Mexico Evalúa, and then the other organization that was mentioned on this program.
Yeah, this is kind of, we've talked about this on the program. I think this is a good example of, you know, how these NGOs are useful to corporate media because, you know, they're right there. They have important sounding names and they give, you know, sound bites and reports that allow corporate media to sound like they're reinforcing, you know, their points. So two of the questions in the interview, one had to do with Transparency International suggesting that there'd been no substantial advances in the anti-corruption fight over these 5 years. And Mexico Evalúa basically saying the same thing about the lack of advance on impunity, right? And that was clearly the weakest part of the interview. I think a cursory look at what AMLO has done over 5 years. If you want to look at the fight against oil theft with the huachicol, huachicoleros, taking on the lobby of pharmaceuticals and the mafia of 10 companies that were controlling the distribution of medicines in this country, getting rich people and corporations to pay more of their share of taxes, going after the private hospital and private, you know, prison racket. I could go on and on. But it's just absolute bad faith to say that there's been no advances in the anti-corruption and the anti-impunity fight by AMLO over 5 years. So what they do then is they try to say, well, Transparency International says that, right? Well, Transparency International is, right, an organization that, you know, has collaborated with USAID and gets money from the State Department, right? Actually, and one other point, the adversary says, but the State Department says, right, as if the State Department was never known to lie about anything. So, yeah, if you go a little bit down on that with the funding sources, I mean, it gets funding from the State Department, from the UK government, and whatever. So, enough, that's just, you know, grounds enough to call into question, you know, what are these NGOs' agendas?
Yeah. And I think also the fact that they think that this is the means of responding to the point that the president was trying to make speaks to the fact that this is one of the pitfalls of sending somebody who's unfamiliar with the country to come and do this interview.
That's
because
right.
When López Obrador talked about in the campaign trail and the way that he responded to last night, when he talks about cleaning up corruption from the top, the way he did, you know, in that famous ad,
like sweeping
las escaleras, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The way you clean the stairs from the top down, is that there needs to be an understanding that corruption was built into Mexico's political system. It was acknowledged as being integral to the way that government functioned in this country under previous regimes, where quite literally there was a blessing coming from Los Pinos, from the headquarters of the executive, to say that, yeah, you got to grease the wheels, right? You got to do what you got to do to make things happen. And that is absolutely true that it has stopped, right? Is there still corruption in this country? Of course there is. Name a country there isn't. In fact, nobody ever talks about eliminating corruption in a serious way. We talk about eliminating impunity, being that they're making sure that there's actual consequences for it and that it's not being sanctioned from the top. And I think we can safely say that that is one of the definitive things that marks this government. Even though there's still a long way to go in terms of it combating corruption in a generalized way, the fact that it's not sanctioned from the very top anymore, that it's not seen as part of the system, I think is very important. And with what he was trying to communicate and what the public understands, which is that, you know, one of the reasons López Obrador was elected in 2018 in that landslide election was precisely because of the frustration that the population felt when it came to issues of corruption. And if the population continues to show support for López Obrador, and we'll get to that a little bit later in the program. In fact, we just recently saw a poll where he went up in support. It's because they understand that the president has made that instruction that this is no longer a permissible conduct within the halls of power under my administration or the López Obrador administration. And I think that's really key to understand.
I think that's exactly right. And the other organization that was mentioned in the interview is actually an even worse case, which is México Evalúa. Right, México Evalúa not only gets money from USAID, right, to the tune of $3 million over the last 5 years, right, but it's also part of the Atlas Network, the worldwide network of ultra right wing organizations. It's the think tank that creates think tanks, right, to create tentacles in all these countries to support, you know, far-right causes, right? Anything from pharmaceuticals to tobacco to anti-climate change, right? And look, you know, it's Mexico Evalúa gets USAID money. It gets National Endowment for Democracy money. It's part of the Atlas Network, right? Mexico Evalúa is part of the opposition network in Mexico. That's just the case, right? The people who are in México Evalúa write columns against the 4T all the time. They're in the media all the time. Right? That's just, you know, that's just a fact. Right? And this is what happens in these interviews. They throw out these names. They don't tell you who they are. You know, I made the kind of the crack today on Twitter that it should be like food labeling. Right? They're now requiring food labeling so you know what ingredients are in your food. But they never tell you, right, where these, you know, these experts on cable news, you know, where they're from, where they, you know, where their financing comes from, right? What think tanks they work for, they don't tell you. And the organizations they mention in these interviews, they don't tell you their background. It's important to know. Excuse me. It's important to know that Mexico Valúa is tied both to USAID and to the Atlas Network, right? It's important to know about Transparency International as well. And what's the problem with USAID, you know, if you don't know? It's because USAID does openly, right, and this has been stated, what the CIA used to do covertly, right? When the CIA was getting a lot of blowback, right, for its very nefarious activities after, you know, the decades after World War II, they set up organizations like USAID and NED, especially, to openly do what was covertly done before, with the idea that, and this was actually kind of brilliant, that if it's done openly right under your nose, you're not going to know it as much, because it's just right out there. It's just right out there. USAID in Mexico is supporting organizations, you know, like Mexico Valúa, right? Like Mexicans Against Corruption and Impunity, which is run by the leading opposition figure in this country, Claudio X González, right? And the Mexican public knows this. You know, those who, you know, want to care to acknowledge it, which is, you know, the majority. So it's important to know where these organizations are coming from and who's behind them, right? And this is, you know, something that happens in most all interviews, and it happened in this one.
Now, of course, so there's the interview. People can watch it for themselves. It's available online. You know, our program's in English, and then there's plenty of materials out there that are subtitled or even dubbed from the original broadcast. Check it out if you want. But one thing I wanted to talk about as well has been a bit of the reaction. So domestically, oh, yeah. I think I would say most people, like I said at the beginning, probably expected that they were going to, you know, it was going to be a tough interview, that they were really going to grill him. Ultimately, that's not what happened. It was pretty, as Jesus said in that string, anticlimactic, I would say. You know, not a big deal, not a big splash. Certainly silenced some of those people that tried to accuse him of only, you know, having interviews with people that would be friendly, which of course also runs contrary to the fact that every day he holds a press conference and every day he faces tough questions. But anyway.
Every day.
One thing in particular really seemed to make some waves outside of the country, which is what we had to say about immigration. As we know, immigration is, aside from the fact that, you know, that this is probably the most important issue in the bilateral relationship, it's probably one of the key issues shaping up to be in the U.S. presidential election. You know, the Republicans have really been driving this. We've seen that really hard right shift by the Democrats, talking about shutting down the border, et cetera, et cetera. So we know this is going to be an election topic. And again, to their credit, they actually said what López Obrador's position is. So yeah. I'm going to show the whole program from the actual episode and so that we can watch it for ourselves. This is actually a clip of what aired that day during this program.
With the ear of the White House, President López Obrador proposed his fix that the United States commit $20 billion a year to poor countries in Latin America and the Caribbean, lift sanctions on Venezuela, end the Cuban embargo, and legalize millions of law-abiding Mexicans living in the U.S.
If they don't do the things that you said need to be done, then what?
The flow of migrants will continue.
Your critics have said what you're doing or what you're asking for to help secure the border is diplomatic blackmail. What do you say?
I'm speaking frankly. We have to say things as they are. And I always say what I feel. I always say what I think.
If they don't do those things, will you continue to help to secure the border?
Yes, because our relationship is very important. It is fundamental.
So there you have it. The actual clip that went out on the air. And again, to their credit, they actually mentioned this because I do a lot of work around migration. It's one of the areas that I cover in my work as a journalist. And in fact, it's really frustrating to see how little is said of what is the actual positions of the Mexican president. And as they said very clearly, commit to funding $20 billion a year, poor countries in the region, particularly those that are seen as sources of migrants, right? Lift the sanctions on Venezuela, end the Cuban embargo, and provide some kind of legalization to Mexicans already living in the United States. This is the position of most migrants' rights advocates. This is what people have been calling for a really long time. And one part that I really like to emphasize is the fact that he talks about sanctions on Venezuela, the unilateral coercive measures, and the Cuban blockade. This needs to be talked about. These are the countries that are generally, especially Venezuela, although lately we've seen many more numbers coming from Haiti, are the countries that are the source of migration. And the reason is U.S. imperialism. It's the interference of the United States in these countries. So end that interference, and you will see that these flows will be reduced. So at the very least, we got a chance to talk about that on this program. But Kurt, I'll hand it over to you. Talk to us about the reaction. What have you been seeing on social media in terms of this, from my point of view, very reasonable political position?
Yeah, it is a reasonable position. And, you know, it's a counter offer. That's how you discuss. That's how you negotiate, right? A proposal, and you discuss, right? And I think it was actually probably the most interesting part of the interview, right? Because, you know, she said, what will happen if these measures aren't implemented? He said immigration will continue, which some have interpreted as being a blackmail. I see it as more as a statement of fact. It's not a blackmail, right? If you don't address the systemic factors underlying immigration, it will continue, regardless of what Mexico does or doesn't do, right? If the United States continues to have an interventionist policy, it continues to apply sanctions and embargoes, right? Migration flows will continue. He's just stating the fact. And, you know, then she follows up saying, does that mean you're not going to cooperate with immigration? He says, no. Basically, calm down, right? But it's amazing how triggered people can get by this. So 60 Minutes, to their credit, devoted a series of tweets to the interview, right? And laid out, right, the proposal that Jose Luis just told us, $20 billion a year, for programs that have already been proven to work in Mexico. He's not just pulling programs out of a hat, right? This is Jóvenes Construyendo el Futuro, Young People Building the Future, which is a program of paid work placements for young people that either aren't working or aren't studying, right? And Sembrando Vida, Planting Life, which is an environmental tree planting program, which has now been operating for 5 years in Mexico and is already Mexico's financing it to be extended into Central America. $20 billion a year, right? $20 billion a year is so nothing for the United States. It is so nothing. The military budget is over $800 billion a year, plus supplemental war budgets. $20 billion a year is nothing, right? Nothing.
I need you to say.
Compared to how much they've given to Ukraine, $20 billion is nothing.
At the end of the day, they might end up saving money because then they wouldn't be spending so many resources on the militarization of the U.S. southern border, which costs a lot of money, especially with kind of these random moments where they'll deploy the National Guard and all of the costs that incurs, or, when they put up this barbed wire, which is torn down the next morning, et cetera, right? Ultimately, at the end of the day, it probably would be a cost-saving measure if they actually address the root causes of migration, right? And the Biden administration loves to talk about that, uses that language all the time. But anybody who's actually analyzed what their proposal is, they emphasize private investment, that we need to have the private sector generate jobs there. And the truth is that in the case of Central America in particular, if there isn't incentive, if there isn't support, if there isn't stimulus, these companies are not going to establish themselves, and the solution is not going to come from the private sector. There has to be state intervention to be able to you know, stem the flow of migrants, right? You know, one of the things that López Obrador also always talks about is that migration should be because of people wanting to, not because they have to, right? A lot of the people who leave, you know, I've been to the Guatemala-Mexico border many, many times. Most people will tell you the same thing. They're like, listen, if I had the choice, I would stay. Of course I would. You know, I've mentioned before that I live near the bus terminal here in Mexico City, talking to Venezuelan migrants. They all say the same thing. You know, if the economic situation in my country improves, of course, I'll be on the next plane back because they want to stay in their communities, right? And I think if you actually provide it, like López Obrador is suggesting, then you might actually see a reduction of all those apprehensions that, you know, the Republicans are so worried about happening on the U.S. southern border.
Yeah. And I think this underscores what you said before. This is a reasonable proposal. $20 billion is a reasonable ask. And it's for programs that have already been, you know, have a track record, right? It just, this just boggles the mind of, you know, the American paradigm, which is used to shoveling money only into security cooperation, only into police, only into military, right, and only into, you know, private sector subsidies, right? Not something that could actually, you know, work on the ground, right? Even, you know, above and beyond the fact that it's not even that much money. So,
we also saw.
Hold on, let me just get the. The responses. So
exactly.
60 Minutes devotes a tweet to this very reasonable proposal, right, from Mexico's point of view, right? And just, I just want to read some of the responses to this, right? The president of Mexico's proposal for stemming immigration includes the U.S. commit $20 billion a year to poor countries in Latin America and the Caribbean, lift sanctions in Venezuela, end the Cuban embargo, right, which Obama was working towards, right, not too long ago. It seems like ancient history now. Legalized law-abiding Mexicans living in the U.S., right, who I think have been there over 5 years. Some of the responses from the illuminated American public. How about declare war on Mexico? So basically he is blackmailing. That is what you get from a narco state. How about we just build the wall, arm it with soldiers, and tell them to fuck off? How about you go fuck off? And say, this is going to get an R rating today, but whatever. How about no, go fuck yourselves? A true president would tell the president of Mexico to go fuck themselves and then depose them in a coup. Who the hell is he to tell us what to do? It's a money grab and everyone knows it. He could help keep his own people on his side of the border and not allow a flourishing freeway through his country, but no, just hand us money. We'll quiet things down for a couple of months. Then, right, why should the United States of America be piggy bank of the world? They're just giving you a few of these, right? Let's see, scrolling down, hold on just a second. This is just to give you an idea, right? There's a couple, I think there's a nuclear war gif down here. you know, real subtle stuff. Let's see what else. Alternate proposal. We take 50% of all remittances sent to Mexico as a tax and use it to build a wall while slapping a 50% tariff on all Mexican goods coming into America until Mexico agrees to cooperate with us in securing the border. Right? Considering that Mexico is now United States' number one supplier, good luck on the tariff idea. Right? And see how that raises prices in the U.S. No, shut the damn border and stop remissions back to Mexico and start the largest mass deportation in history. Beggar. AMLO's a beggar, right? Best I can do is go fuck yourself, right? You do realize this is blackmail, right? This is extortion, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? How triggering is this that one U.S. media outlet once reports on what the Mexican president's counterproposal is? People can't handle it. People simply can't handle it, right? And just this arrogance, you know, right now, American proxies are getting, you know, pretty mauled around the world. You know, American proxies are not doing really well around the world. But that hasn't just put a dent into American arrogance at all. You know?
No, and you can tell.
Bomb them, you know, black man, station, blah, blah, blah. This is why the immigration debate is where it is.
Right? Yeah. And you can tell they didn't even bother to watch the program. They're just reacting to whatever they see on social media. Because if they had, they would have seen that conversation that they had on the show in the interview about the fact that Mexico has now outpaced China, outpaced Canada, as the U.S.'s number one trading relationship. And López Obrador was respectful in that sense. He said, we need each other, right? If you want to impose these kind of punishing tariffs, what do you think that's going to do to your supply chains? He talked about those. Mm-hmm. Now, these are deeply integrated economies, for better or for worse, right? There's obviously a negative side to this. Mm-hmm. We don't have time to get into that tonight. But the point is that this kind of arrogance to think that, you know, you can just kind of do whatever you want, and anybody who dares to push back or advocate against the consensus political positions in that country are out to lunch, right? This kind of broad reaction. And I had up on the screen a little bit more of a measured, a more reasonable political voice speaking here. But you had an interesting response to this as well here, where he says, President López Obrador, sadly, the reporter allows the president to escape with incomplete and very misleading responses. Worth watching for those well-informed on Mexico. And you said something along the lines of, well, if Earl Anthony Wayne, who, according to his own bio, is a resident at AU School of International Service,
and part of the Wilson Center.
Where else?
Our friends at the Wilson Center. Yeah.
And career ambassador, right? So if this is what he felt, you know, what does it say about the program?
Yeah. Well, what I said was, if he's upset, then the interview was worth it just for that. Just for that. And actually, the one of the few sane responses to that 60 Minutes tweet was actually from somebody from China. You know, very interesting, right? From the China Daily EU bureau chief. Right.
Oh, he's. Do you not know him? Oh, he's famous.
Blunt and to the point, the U.S. is not a stabilizing force in its own neighborhood. A destabilizing force regarding its 60-plus years of embargo to impoverished Cubans. Ironically, the U.S. also wants to sow discord and create a mess in Asia. Boom. Right. Would that we could have this entire debate. Right. Hear the U.S. point of view, hear Mexico's point of view, you know, get all of this history in there, get all this context in there, and wouldn't this be a lot more educational, be a lot more illustrative? Then go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
Blackmail.
Ben?
U.S.'s role historically in creating the very thing that they then pretend to hate.
And I feel sad, really, because as we know, this debate, it's not going to get any healthier. It's not going to get any more profound.
No, it's going to get worse, if anything.
It's going to get worse. It's going to be about who can be more vile, who can be more reactionary when it comes to border issues, right? Mm-hmm. The Democrats, I think, committed a huge blunder by trying to pivot to the hard right and talk about shutting down the border, and then trying to beat the Republicans at their own game and trying to suggest, well, we wanted to solve the issue, right? And, you know, and also the blatant disregard for Mexican sovereignty, right? In fact, that was part of the segment that I think is on the online-only piece, where they actually show a clip of the Speaker of the House of Representatives saying that, like, we'll just tell Mexico what to do. We're the United States. Hang on. And he was, again, to his credit, respectfully, he's like, you know, with all due respect, you know, that's not a way that you should be addressing, you know, your number one trade partner. But that's the attitude, right? And if the Speaker of the Republic of the U.S. House of Representatives, a Republican, it talks like this, imagine the discourse online, right? And so it's only going to get worse. And ultimately, who's going to pay the price? It's going to be the migrants, the refugees, the asylum seekers who are protected by international law to be able to go and seek asylum and be able to find refuge somewhere from persecution, right? That always gets left out of the discussion as well, right? They talk about it like it's just a bargaining chip. Like it's just, you know, the topic of the day on the, you know, the 24-hour news programs. But there are lives at stake, and they deserve to be protected. They have human rights. You know, again, these are concepts that actually need to be treated with the seriousness that they deserve, and they're not, right? And any time that there's an attempt to, there's like what you said, right? F off and F this and how, who are you to tell us what to do, et cetera, et cetera. But it's also an attitude that I think, unfortunately, is very much cultivated by the political culture in the United States, of wanting to limit it to something just so flippant, so juvenile.
Yeah, so base, right? You know, Trump has been talking about basically wanting to bring back Operation Wetback from the Eisenhower years, right? And I think what people don't know about that is that swept up in that mass deportation in the 50s were thousands of legal U.S. citizens who were thrown out of the country.
Right.
It would be good to go back and study the history of these things.
Mm-hmm. A little bit more.
That's right. And so, moving on to our next topic, you know, unfortunately, one of the things that we've seen creeping its way into Mexico has been this negative style of campaigning, these dirty campaigns. We've spoken about it extensively on this podcast, but I wanted to share with you a very troubling development that I think merits our response and a few minutes of our conversation here, which is that this story that came out just this week, from TV Azteca. We'll get into TV Azteca's role in all of this, but essentially to sum it up, last week, Clara Brugada, Morena's candidate for jefa de gobierno here in the capital, which is the equivalent of governor of Mexico City, goes to Ibero University. Ibero is one of the most expensive private universities. It's located in a very tony neighborhood of Santa Fe. Mostly upper middle class, upper class students go there. It's kind of one of their select schools. So suffice it to say, it was a hostile environment for the leftist candidate seeking the governorship of Mexico City. But again, you know, to her credit, goes and faces what was widely expected to be kind of an aggressive audience. But something curious happened right beforehand. There was a protest of people wearing shirts demanding justice in the case of the forcibly disappeared 43 students from the Ayotzinapa Teachers Training College in Guerrero State, here in Mexico, protesting with defaced banners of Clara Brugada, somewhat impeding the entry of vehicles, chanting slogans. But ultimately, in this article that I wrote for our website, mexicosolidarity.com, it was what I think the most appropriate term is false flag protests.
Yeah.
Now, anybody who's worked as a journalist covering this probably had the same reaction that I did when I saw that video, which is, this does not look authentic.
You called that very quickly.
Yeah, as soon as I saw it, it came across my timeline on Twitter, on X, and I was like, this does not smell right whatsoever. And it's a couple of things that are quite obvious. One, people from the state of Guerrero have a certain body type. They didn't quite match up. You know, they are usually of a darker complexion, right? They are generally of shorter height. And all of the people that were participating in this demonstration did not fit that profile, right? But I think the indictment was the fact that they didn't even know the chants. So at the protest for the missing 43 students, the normalistas, as they're called, the students who attend the teachers' training colleges, they have actually a really powerful way of protesting. They practice in their schools, and they'll chant in a way that is really quite loud and quite booming with a lot of confidence behind it. And these were kind of really quiet, almost like they were timid, like they were scared or shy, you know, saying things like Zapata vive vive, but even then getting confused and saying Ayotzi vive vive, right? Like just something that would not happen. And of course, I wasn't the only one, right? And so, as I said here, there was a number of voices, including, so he's more commonly known as Omar Garcia, but his real name is Manuel Vasquez Arellano. So he actually used to be part of the political organization of the Normalistas at the Ayotzinapa Teachers Training College. He is a survivor of the actual attack on that night in September in 2014. He witnessed the repression by the state security officials that night. So he now serves as a representative, as a diputado in the lower house of Congress here in Mexico. And he said in a video, these individuals clearly are not from the Ayotzinapa Teachers Training College. Other journalists also quite quickly picked up on the fact that none of this was convincing in terms of actually representing it. And then at the end of the day, the actual Facebook page of Ayotzinapa, so they have, it's called the Propaganda and Press Commission, Mesa Post, denying that they had anything to do with this protest. So we distance ourselves from the actions carried out by third parties on behalf of our institutions. So all of that to say, somebody I can't say who, but I think if we put two and two together, we can guess who was behind this, paid people to go and pretend that they were students from Ayotzinapa, had them wear t-shirts, had them go and rip down posters with the candidate's face on it, deface it, and then go and do this protest. And then what happens? TV Azteca goes and shares this video on their social media without any kind of qualifying comments whatsoever, saying there is a protest of Ayotzinapa students in front of the entrance to the Ibero University to demonstrate against Clara Brugada, clearly as part of an effort to drive a wedge between that social movement, where there are some tense relations, and Morena, the party that is seeking to win the jefatura de gobierno here in Mexico City, and obviously the presidency with Claudia Sheinbaum. So to me, that is the dirty campaign. This is what we're warning about. And this is, I think, particularly dangerous. Like, we know that they're going to invent all kinds of things. But what they're trying to do here, and the part that makes me so concerned, is the fact that this is a social movement. And there's a lot, you know, the parents of the forcibly disappeared students did tours in the United States. There's a lot of people who are familiar with this movement and what they did and how much that moment represented the decline of the old regime, the depravity of the previous PRIAN that was in power in this country. And to try to drive that wedge, I think, is really worrisome. And it really speaks to the kind of campaign that we're going to see continue to evolve. And all that to add to the fact that while we're talking right now about the Mexico City level, at the federal level, Max Cortázar just received a promotion from Xochitl Gálvez's campaign. So what does that tell us? What does that tell you, Kurt? What do you think that this means for the campaign?
Yeah. This is what a dirty war is. You know, a dirty war is not pretty. Now, López Obrador's performance with regards to getting at the bottom of Ayotzinapa leaves a lot to be desired, right? Well, that's, I think, probably a topic for another program, right? I think we'll certainly agree on that. This has been one of the areas where AMLO's government hasn't fulfilled its promises. There was progress over the first few years, and we learned a lot more about Ayotzinapa than we had before, that the students had been divided into different groups, that there was a military plant inside the students' group that actually was killed together with them. we learned a bunch of stuff that we didn't know beforehand. All right? But then it hit a wall. You know, it hit a wall around the time when the former prosecutor, Omar Gomez Trejo, left. It hit a wall that clearly has to do with military resistance. So that's a fact, right? AMLO hasn't fulfilled Ayotzinapa yet, right? And, you know, it doesn't look good. But this was clearly a false flag operation, and it was clearly designed to do exactly what José Luis said. Right? It was to create a wedge between, you know, where there already are tensions, right? Just, you know, a couple weeks ago, students people associated, knocked down the doors of National Palace during the morning press conference and such, to drive a wedge between the movement and Morena, right? And here's another piece of the puzzle, right? At the same time this happens, the owner of the television network, TV Azteca, you know, which ran this fake, right? Turns out this guy, Ricardo Sinanes Pliego, who also owns the Azteca Bank, who owns the Electra chain of stores, has a little bit of a tax problem. Just a little bit of a tax problem, right? AMLO had said that he owed somewhere in the neighborhood of 25 billion pesos, right, through fiscal credits and such that he received from previous governments and, you know, didn't pay back, and a couple from this one, and back unpaid taxes, right? Then Alvaro Delgado of Sin Embargo did an investigation and turned out that, no, it wasn't 25 billion pesos. It was over 60 billion pesos, right? That's almost $3 billion in taxes that he owes. $3 billion, right? That's more than the budgets of certain states, and it's more than the budget of the governance secretariat. I mean, it's just a huge, it's a staggering amount of a back tax bill, right? And it shows exactly how the tax system worked in Mexico before AMLO, right? Somebody gets fiscal credits, he doesn't pay them back. Instead of turning off the spigot, they give him more. Somebody doesn't pay taxes, and the taxes just back then were just condoned or ignored, right? Or, you know, you get your battery of tax lawyers in there, and, you know, they postpone everything and kick the can down the road and try to get a very friendly judiciary system to, you know, stick their hand in for you. Right? This has been an ongoing battle over the course of this entire sexennium, right? Which, going back to the previous point about Transparency International saying, oh, there hasn't been any advances in corruption, or make of a law, oh, there hasn't been any advances in impunity. What was the impunity like before that created something like Salinas Pliego that AMLO is now going after? Right? He's one of the richest men in Mexico. And he made his fortune, like many of the Mexico's millionaires and multimillionaires, these are not self-made men. These are people who benefited from the mass privatization of the state in the 80s and 90s. Right? So Salinas Pliego got a TV station that used to be a public television station. Got a TV station and has used it systematically to advance his own interests. From the 1990s, you know, we can go back to ancient history here, right? When he made a whole stink about the assassination of a guy called Paco Stanley, right, who was a member of the Azteca team, as a way to try to club the first left-wing mayor in the history of Mexico City, who was Cuauhtémoc Cárdenas. Huge thing about Paco Stanley, right? At the beginning of the pandemic, he had his own attack dog there, his anchor man, his own Javier Latorre, say, don't listen to López-Gatell, who was the subsecretary of health at the time, right? Don't listen to the subsecretary of health. Why did he do that? Because he wanted his workers to continue to have to go to work during a pandemic at his electric stores and didn't want to close them down at the risk of their lives. This is who Salinas Pliego is, right? Just a couple weeks ago, he had, among other things, Salinas Pliego had a golf course in Huatulco. Nice golf course, nice license. Public money paid for the maintenance and upkeep, so it was a great deal for him. The license expired in 2022. AMLO says, hey, do you want to buy it, or what do you want to do here? Didn't want to buy it. So AMLO says, all right, well, we're going to turn this golf course into a nature reserve and a public beach. And that just happened. And now he's fighting that. And he going crazy about that. Went crazy about it. So that it's allowed me to post my favorite, one of my favorite George Carlin clips about golf courses, right?
I mean, it says it all, because in fact, they were circulating this aerial shot of the golf course. Obviously, the grass is not as green, right? Because they're not watering it and using those valuable resources in the middle of a drought to keep the greens green.
Right.
You know, saying like, look what happens once the state takes over. They let things go to ruin. And then 2 days later, starts posting about, oh, the ecocide that is happening in the Yucatan as a result of the Tren Maya. So which is it? Are you an environmentalist? Do you believe in actually taking measures to mitigate against environmental damage? Or are you a rich man who likes his golf courses staying green, right? You know, and you were talking about some of his worst moments, the Michael Stanley thing I had forgotten about, but that's absolutely true. But it wasn't that long ago. In this government, when the Secretary of Education published the new textbook, saying, this is the new way we're going to do textbooks. This is instead of like sort of just very specific materials, what we're going to do is projects. I have a kid who's almost 10 years old, so I've seen the materials. It's basically, it's a different conception, it's a different kind of curriculum, but still mostly the same kinds of topics. Oh, but he lost his mind. And he sends his attack dog, Javier Alatorre, and all the rest of them from TV Azteca to go out and quite literally, in sort of an episode out of the 50s, go on a Red Scare campaign saying how they want to turn your children communist through the education system. And I'll remind listeners that Mexico, actually, its official education program in the 30s was called socialist education. So even if that was the case, which it's not, does not offend the sensibilities of the population here. We've been there. We're accustomed to it. But that was the campaign, and it speaks to the way that I sum it up, it's the face of class struggle in Mexico right now. You know, for all of those people who identify with the left and have been critical of López Obrador, saying he's not leftist enough, oh, he's not this, he's not that, he's not charging taxes, et cetera, et cetera. I think this shows the fact that, yes, there is a class struggle happening in this country right now. Somebody like Salinas Pliego, one of the richest men in this country, going on an all-out campaign against López Obrador in an election period,
right?
I think tells you that they would rather have the opposition in power because the opposition is going to go back to, you know, giving them those tax breaks and handing over public land to concessions for cheap, right? Or to continue treating segments, entire regions of the country as a place where all the only interesting thing is cheap labor, et cetera, et cetera, right? Salinas Pliego is the face of class struggle in Mexico and is very much almost on a mission to prove it by saying these things, by going on these tirades, by releasing this really kind of unhinged video online, if I could, where like quite, you know, people kept commenting on his eyes, just basically bulging out of his head out of, you know, as he spoke. So just all the people like, who say that.
Yeah, just almost like a parody of the evil magnate, right?
Yeah.
Who loses it. Right. And, you know, spends his time on Twitter insulting people. Right.
Yeah. In fact, I was looking for that video and it took me a while of scrolling to even find it just because he's a prolific poster. And it's not like he has a team that's doing it. It's him.
No, it's him.
Quite weird. Don't you have businesses to run?
Like yeah. You know, someone who just transparently uses the second largest television network in this country given to him. as his own baby, right? For the worst causes. For the worst causes. Like, let's make workers have to come to work during a pandemic kind of causes, right?
Don't
make me pay my taxes.
Because that's the thing, right? One of the criticisms I actually think is correct is that López Obrador didn't actually try to raise taxes on the wealthy in this country. But what he did do is actually make them pay for once. And that's what this is. Mm-hmm. No law has been changed. All he said, he went to the equivalent of the IRS, the SAT. Hey, make up some teams, find out who owes taxes, and go after them. You can even cut deals if you want. Give them a discount, but have them pay. But he doesn't want to pay a penny.
Yeah.
Because he thinks that the state exists to serve people of the 1% as opposed to the mass majority. So that brings us to the very end of our program. As always, we have to do the shit coverage of Mexico segment. I don't know. We got to come up with a better name for it. Listeners, if you're tuning in right now, give us some ideas. The shit article of the week. This is already getting the R rating, so I'm going to use that word.
Yeah.
But before we get into that, I do want to – there's this great comic that we saw on social media here, which kind of says it all. All right. So at the bottom there, it reads presidential approval ratings. And on the left, there's a large green bar that reads 73%. On the right, 24%. So we recently got some new numbers coming out from polling firms proving yet again López Obrador continues to command extraordinary amount of support in this country. I don't think he's ever dipped below 55%. Correct me if I'm wrong. But it's generally, the floor has been around 60% and now has reached 73%. But here's the interesting detail. So what is propping up that 73% in this image? Well, it's an image of the logo for X.com, Twitter, the New York Times logo, and the ProPublica logo. So why would that be there? Well, the dirty campaign, right? The bot armies, the troll centers, the poor reporting coming out of the New York Times, the irresponsible journalism from ProPublica. What did it do?
It just raised AMLO's approval rating 11 points.
It went up.
By the conservative newspaper Reforma, which hates AMLO.
Right? That's right. That's right. That's where the poll came from. Yep.
No, we can debate why Reforma, you know, decided to put this out, if they're trying to play nice, what it up. But you know, this has been confirmed by other polling sites as well. And I think this is just a great illustrative cartoon by, you know, Jose Hernandez, right?
Yeah, it says it all.
The boomerang effect. And I have a whole new piece out just today in Jacobin if you want to know more about how the New York Times, ProPublica, and X helped AMLO's rating improve.
Absolutely. Check out his writing. So there we go. So maybe this next report that we'll go into will have the same effect. So we saw this piece, and there's a story here that I think is actually quite interesting and raises a lot of questions that we don't quite have answers to. But here's the piece. Mexico's president says he won't confront cartels on U.S. orders. And I'll just read the lead. Mexico's president said Friday he won't fight Mexican drug cartels on U.S. order in the clearest explanation yet of his refusal to confront the gangs. Over the years, President Andrés Manuel López Obrador has laid out various justifications for his hugs not policy of avoiding clashes with the cartels. In the past, he has said you cannot fight violence with violence, and on other occasions, he has argued the government has to address the causes, in scare quotes, of drug violence, ascribing them to poverty or a lack of opportunities. Now, what's the story here? Because something very weird happened with this story, which was, now we know, written by Mark Stevenson coming over the AP wire. But what did you see initially?
Well, that's exactly right, Jose Luis. So, you know, this is just another, you know, dumb piece for a variety of reasons, right? As you mentioned there, the lead, right? Then also, you know, a little bit farther down, it talks about how, you know, this is just another classic of lazy journalism, right? Where it says, where is it here? Let me just find it. López Obrador's view, like many of his policies, harkens back to the 1970s. You know, a period when many officials believed that a Mexican cartel selling drugs to gringos was the U.S. issue, not a Mexican one. As if people only thought that in that decade, right? So I wrote a tweet yesterday, right, asking the supposed author of the piece what she meant by that, right? Amora Curry, right, whose name was on the byline, right? I said, so what specific programs of AMLO's are equivalent to specific programs in the 1970s? Because people repeat this ad nauseum. AMLO's a throwback to the 1970s. So I want to know what specific programs of AMLO's are equivalent to the 1970s, right? Is it the pensions? Because those didn't exist in the 1970s. Is it the scholarships? Because those didn't exist in the 1970s. Is it the disability pension? Because those didn't exist in the 1970s. Aid to dependent mothers? Those didn't exist in the 1970s. What is it? What is it that makes him so 70, that 70s guy, right? And so she writes back on Twitter saying, I didn't write that article. Right? This, it almost reminded me of that time in the El País when I questioned the reporter from El País about that line about AMLO wanted to seek re-election. He's like, oh, I didn't write that. That was the translator. Okay. So in this time, not only did she not write a certain line, she said, I didn't write the whole piece, and I haven't worked for PBS in like 3 or 4 years. What? What? I could see maybe you can get a byline wrong for a little while with a current employee. But to get the byline wrong, have it stay wrong for days, nobody noticed it, and have it be someone who doesn't even work there anymore and hasn't for years is remarkably suspicious. It's remarkably suspicious. And even if it's just incompetence, it's part and parcel of another shitty piece from PBS. Right? And then it turns out, well, who wrote it but our friend from last week's segment, right, Mark Stevenson, who wrote the dumb piece of the week last episode about AMLO dislikes police, right?
So in the best of circumstances, this was an oversight. Somebody somewhere in the back end, you know, I've worked in newsrooms. It happens. You assign the wrong author to the byline. But the worst case, and I'm glad you mentioned that piece about the translator, something fishy is going on here.
Yeah.
Right? How are you this careless about your coverage of, again, your number one trading partner of a country that is playing an outsized role in your current election process? Something doesn't add up. And I think speaks to the fact that there are probably some editorial decisions being made that are very much informed by an anti-Mexico bias. Otherwise, how does this get actually passed several eyes? Because it's not just the person who wrote it, it's the person who uploaded it, it's the person who edited it, it's also the web editor, right? Like, there's a lot of different actors involved. Just read the end of any Reuters piece. You will see five names listed for a piece that is maybe 200 words long. There's a lot of eyes that go over this. How does that happen? And of course, why do stories about Mexico continue to be assigned to Mark Stevenson when he's so incapable of being an unbiased journalist when it comes to his coverage? And I threw up here on the screen here, the thread that you had about this, and you actually see the person that they had claimed originally had been written it, saying, thank you for correcting. I've reached out to a former coworker in hopes to correct the byline so you can conduct your concerns accordingly. And even, they mentioned, I'll go back to making my private sector podcast, right? So somebody clearly had nothing to do with this piece, nothing to do with PBS anymore. And then, you know, finally correcting the record and seeing it's an AP story. But as we said, turns out it was written by somebody who, for his own reasons, deserves a lot of scrutiny.
Yeah. And, you know, ends his piece by claiming that homicides had already begun to fall under Peña Nieto, right? The previous president.
Not true.
Right. Not even, you know, acknowledging that the biggest drop has been in this past year. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just biased reporting. And it's over and over again, right? And we've seen this kind of behavior from, as we've seen from El País, we've the whole, you know, run on supposedly narco AMLO from ProPublica, from Deutsche Welle, from Inside Crime, the worst piece of all the New York Times. So when you start seeing a series of hits, right, against Mexico, against AMLO, you start to ask questions. Yeah, I mean, I think that's a pretty natural thing to do. Why would PBS, you know, this isn't just also a question of just getting the name wrong. It wasn't their piece. It was the AP's piece.
Yeah.
It was an AP piece. So that seems like a harder thing to get wrong. If you're pulling something off of AP, it's AP. But they put one of their names on it from someone who doesn't even work there anymore. It's very bizarre. You know?
Yeah.
Added up to all the other sloppiness and slipshod reporting about Mexico, it's just all very bizarre.
I wanted to end on that note, right? Like, this kind of framing, really, we've talked about it before, but I find it really frustrating, right? Clearest explanation yet of its refusal to confront the gangs, right? Okay, you want us to put the bodies.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're saying, right? From the comfort of your home, wherever Mark is, I think he's in Miami, wherever he is, Washington, you know, Mexicans, they can die so that we can get the drugs on this side. But you got to confront the gangs, right? So we can pretend like something's actually being done. Like the, you know, U.S. war on drugs isn't a colossal failure and hasn't been the case since day one. I find it really, really, really offensive and borderline discriminatory that they think that our lives are so expendable that we should be forced to confront the gangs on behalf of the U.S. because of their problems on their side of the border when it comes to treating the issue as they should, which is a public health concern, not a criminalized issue, as they've been doing unsuccessfully for decades at this point.
And
but that's the narrative.
Yeah, that's the narrative.
That's mainstream media coverage for you.
And it's also, you know, it's like Ukrainian buddies, right? Any buddies that aren't,
right.
Americans are expendable, right, for their foreign policy. It's just a caricaturish, also misunderstanding of AMLO's policy, right? This idea of hugs, not bullets, right? Abrazos, no balazos, a little rhyme. It was a campaign slogan in 2018, right? That indicated an overall policy of, right, addressing the causes of crime and not just trying to, you know, shoot your way out of things, right? But this idea that that's an actual policy, that the National Guard isn't out there, is just such a ridiculous caricature. It was a campaign slogan. That's not the policy. That's not the policy. And if you think that, you're dumb, or you're uninformed, Are you just deliberately making a caricature of it? Right?
Oh, they are, right? They think the hugs are for the narcos, right? Mm-hmm. They quite literally have convinced themselves. In fact, I saw a tweet from, his name's Alexander Raviña. Follow him as well. Takes on Latin America. And he's like, mm-hmm. Wait a minute. I never stopped to think that they think that the hugs are for the narcos. And I was like, no, that's exactly what they think.
Yeah, I saw that.
When the truth is, right? Like the scare quotes in the second paragraphs, mm-hmm. right? Has argued that to address the causes, in scare quotes, of drug violence. That's exactly what it is. It's abrazos for the young people who were left behind by the previous administrations. No balazos for them, right? Like the students who were chased onto their campus and murdered by state security officials under Felipe Calderon, right?
Right.
The idea is that maybe we shouldn't be giving them bullets or making up names like ninis for them, and instead give them opportunities, which is actually the default position of any progressive thinker on the subject inside of the United States. But as soon as you cross that border, as long as you put on those sepia-tinted glasses, mm-hmm. suddenly the only answer is violence, is persecution, is going after the kingpins. It's abiding by whatever the U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency wants. Well, yep. As we started this program, and maybe we'll end on this note here, Mexico is a sovereign country. It's not a colony of anybody. It has its own policies, and it's going to pursue its own policies, and it doesn't need to do the bidding of the United States, even if that makes officials in the DEA upset enough to go and launder their talking points through media outlets in the United States.
And congratulations, Mark. You've won the Dumb Article of the Week award 2 weeks running.
We'll see.
I'm Kurt Hackbarth, and this is the Soberanía Podcast.
And I'm José Luis Granado Ceja. On behalf of the Soberanía Podcast, tune in next time. As always, covering news here in Mexico in the context of the Mexican elections, and also coverage of shitty articles by Mark Stevenson. See you next time.
Bye.